Good afternoon, namaskar. I, Kriti Vadera, would like to welcome all the teachers, learners, educators, students to CIET NCERT's live phone-in program. And you are watching us live on PME Vidya's channel number 12. This session is going to be for standard 12 biology students. And the expert who is joining us today for this particular session, I would like to introduce Mrs. Mridula Arora ji. She is from Navyug School and we will be discussing reproduction in organisms today. It's going to be part third of this chapter. I welcome you, Mrs. Arora, for today's session.
Good afternoon, Priti ma'am, and good afternoon, viewers.
Viewers, we've already had earlier two sessions of this particular chapter, and today is the third follow-up session. And if you have any questions about this chapter, then please do let us know. You can dial on our toll-free number to tell us. Number would be 8800440559. If you want to watch the live streaming of this program, then you may kindly log into our official YouTube channel by the name of NCERT Official. And there also in the live chat box, you may send all your suggestions and questions to us. There is one more medium through which you can dial and contact us. You may send all your suggestions and questions to dth.class12@ciet.nic.in. So these are the various mediums through which you'll be contacting us. And in next 1 hour, we'll be discussing about reproduction in organisms. So let's welcome our guest again. I welcome you again, Ms. Arora. So now in this third session, what all are we going to discuss today?
We are going to talk about the reproduction, its mechanism and various methods of reproduction today.
Okay, so I guess all our viewers must be eagerly waiting as it's going to be the third session of this particular chapter. So you may proceed with your presentation, Mrs. Arora.
Thank you, Kriti. Dear students, I hope you are keeping safe and keeping good health. And I also hope that you are maintaining SMS, that is social distancing, you are wearing masks, as well as using sanitizer or washing your hands to keep yourself healthy. Dear students, today we will be talking about reproduction in organisms. Students, you are all aware that we are surrounded by an amazing variety of living organisms. These organisms have diverse shapes, diverse sizes, and they live in a wide range of habitats. Irrespective of all the diversity exhibited by them, they have some unique identifying features which define them. Growth, reproduction, and ability to respond to the environment are some of the unique features of living organisms. Students, today we shall focus upon reproduction. By the end of this session, students, you will be able to define reproduction and state its significance. You will compare sexual and asexual reproduction. You will explain different methods of asexual reproduction, and you will also explain parthenogenesis, which is a unique step of evolution between asexual and sexual reproduction. You will correlate various events in sexual reproduction and explain embryogenesis. Dear students, you all are aware that reproduction is a vital process for maintaining continuity of species generation after generation. It is defined as a biological process through which an organism gives birth to the individuals of its own kind. The young ones which are produced are identical to the parent organisms. For example, cat produces kittens, cow produces calf, and so on. There is a cycle of birth, growth, reproduction, senescence, that is aging, and then death. Students, we can broadly classify all methods of reproduction into two main categories. One is asexual reproduction and the other one is sexual reproduction. All lower organisms, which are unicellular or simple multicellular organisms, they reproduce by asexual method of reproduction. All multicellular, higher complex organisms reproduce by sexual method of reproduction. Students, asexual method of reproduction involves only one parent. So it is also called as uniparental, because in simple unicellular organisms, we do not find any male or female organisms. When we talk of sexual reproduction, it is biparental. In higher organisms, you can easily see that male and female organisms are different. These male and female organisms, they produce male and female gametes respectively. These gametes are haploid and are produced as a result of reductional division or meiosis. Meiosis involves recombination of genes due to crossing over of the chromosomes. So this recombination of genes as well as fusion of gametes from two different organisms results in variation. These variations are key steps for adaptation and evolution of new species. Thus, sexual reproduction plays a significant role in evolution of organism. Students, when we talk of asexual reproduction, it is uniparental. Moreover, it does not involve formation or fusion of gametes. Since gametes are not formed, meiosis or reductional division also does not take place. Thus, the variations are not produced and the offsprings are truly identical to the parents, and they can also be called as clones. Now, let us focus on different methods of asexual reproduction. We will recapitulate these methods which we had studied in first episode. Students, simple organisms such as protists, they divide by mitosis or amitosis. When the division results in production of two daughter cells who are identical in size, that is, one parent cell divides into two equal half daughter cells, and these daughter cells grow and mature and they further undergo similar divisions. This kind of division or reproduction is called as binary fission. Bi means two. So when one parent cell is producing two daughter cells who are identical in size, it is called as binary fission. It is very common in amoeba, paramecium also. When we talk of Plasmodium, which is a malarial parasite, and another example of protista, here the parent cell divides into a large number of daughter cells. Since a large number of daughter cells are formed, multiple divisions take place. And since it involves multiple division, it is called as multiple fission. So some protists show binary fission and the others show multiple fission. When we move on to algae, one of the very common examples of algae you might have come across is Spirogyra. Spirogyra is a thread-like filamentous algae seen in ponds and lakes. Students, when a particular filament of the Spirogyra breaks up accidentally, it divides into a large number of fragments. Each of these fragments is capable of growing and dividing further to form a multicellular filament identical to the parent cell. Since one fragment is capable of producing whole filament of Spirogyra, this kind of reproduction is called as fragmentation. When we move on to other examples of algae, say for example Chlamydomonas, the mode of reproduction is through zoospores. Zoospores are motile spores which are identical to each other. These zoospores are produced as a result of mitotic division, and they divide and grow and form adult organisms which is truly identical to the parent from which they were formed. When we move on to fungi, spores are produced, but these spores are non-motile spores. In algae, as you see, the zoospores are flagellate and thus they are motile. In fungi, for example, in Penicillium, the spores are non-motile and they are exogenous spores produced on the hyphae. These exogenous non-motile spores are called as conidiospores. They are present in penicillium. These spores may not always be exogenous. There can be endogenous spores also. Students, I am sure you would have seen the spoiled bread at your home. When you look at this spoiled bread, you can see black dots on it. When you observe these black dots under the microscope, you see these are spores, and these spores are produced in the fruiting body called as sporangium. This sporangium, when it becomes full of spore, it bursts open. The spores are released in air and they can be carried by wind to the suitable substratum. When they fall on a suitable substratum having nutrition and moisture, they germinate and they form the hyphae, which form a network called mycelium. So the spores can be exogenous as conidiospores or endogenous as sporangiospores. Some other fungi, say for example yeast, it reproduces by budding. Students, when we were talking of bread, both yeast and bread mold are related to bread. Yeast is a fungus which helps in fermentation of the dough for formation of bread, right? So when the dough for the bread is prepared, this yeast is used. So that is its economic importance. So some fungi can be useful fungi and some can be harmful. Say for example, yeast is helping in formation of bread, and bread mold or rhizopus is helping in decomposition or spoilage of the bread. When we talk of yeast, the method of reproduction in yeast is budding. The parent cell shows protuberance or outgrowth, which is called as bud. This bud gradually grows and attains the same size of the parent cell, or sometimes even without attaining the same size of the parent cell, it may start dividing further and it may start showing protuberance, that is another bud. So you may see a chain of buds on the parent cells. These buds gradually grow and detach from the parent cell and behave independently. Budding is also seen in Hydra, which is an example of coelenterates. So again here, protuberance appears, and gradually this protuberance, it shows tentacles like the parent cell, it grows and then it detaches from the parent cell or the parent organism. So thus, there is a diverse variety of asexual method of reproduction in different groups of lower organisms. It may be fission, it may be budding, it may be fragmentation. In higher organisms, when we talk of plants, they are multicellular organisms. You have seen tall trees around you. Generally, they show sexual method of reproduction, but here also some kind of asexual reproduction is seen. Students, the kind of asexual reproduction in which some vegetative part of the plant helps in the growth and the reproduction of the organism is called as vegetative propagation. Here, the part of the plant which results in the formation of complete plant is called as vegetative propagule. It is definitely a somatic part of the plant. It does not involve seed formation, so it is a kind of asexual reproduction. Thus, variations are not produced. Asexual reproduction in higher plants, it can be through roots, or it can be through stem, or it can be through leaf. Let's first of all talk about the vegetative propagation through roots. When we talk of root vegetative propagation, it can be through taproot, say for example in guava tree, or it can be through adventitious roots, which are swollen tuberous roots in sweet potato, asparagus or dahlia. These swollen tuberous roots, they have adventitious buds. These buds sprout and a young plant is formed. It gradually grows into the complete plant. So sweet potato, dahlia and asparagus, they show vegetative propagation through roots. I'm sure students, you must have eaten sweet potato and enjoyed it. next time when you eat, remember that this sweet potato can be sown in the soil and you can get a new plant from it. Let's talk more about the items or vegetables found in your kitchen. How do they help in vegetative propagation? I'm sure you must have seen potato with buds and nodes at your basket in the kitchen. You can simply sow the potato in the soil and it can result in the formation of the new plant. How does this happen? Students, if you observe carefully, the potato, that is the underground modification of the stem, which stores food, has also bud region in the eyes of the potato. These buds are adventitious buds present in the nodes or the eyes and are capable of growing into complete plant when sown in the soil under suitable conditions. Let's talk further about more items from your kitchen. Everybody eats onion. You have carefully observed onion when you eat. Onion again is an example of underground stem or bulb. It is condensed stem with fleshy leaves over it, and this is the edible part. Generally, we eat fleshy leaves as a salad or even as a masala or ingredient in most of the vegetables. Students, if you carefully observe onion, while you cut the onion, there is an axillary bud present near the condensed shoot of the onion. This axillary bud, when sown in the soil along with the bulb, it can give rise to new plant. Along with the onion, we cannot forget about the ginger because it adds...
Mrs. Arora, as yeah. I have witnessed all three sessions of yours on reproduction in organisms, and right. with these little examples of, where we discussed that biology can be understood within kitchen itself, right from the bread and the fungi and potatoes and onions and now ginger you came on. So before we study it in more detail, there was a curiosity of mine which I would like to ask you here before we go into further details.
Sure.
See, right from middle school classes, we have been, explaining in a way about sexual reproduction and asexual reproduction to our students. But
true.
In 12th standard, I should use the vocabulary as which one is the better way of reproduction to understand it in a wider way? What would you say as a biology teacher?
See, asexual reproduction, since it does not involve fusion of gametes, so it does not result in variation. So whatever characters they are present in the adult plant, they will be carried on as it is. So if you have some desirable characters, then it is good. They will be transferred to the new generation. If there are some features which are undesirable, then it can be harmful also. So when we talk of sexual reproduction, then variations are produced as a result of meiosis as well as fusion of gametes. Since variations are produced, so it provides an additional ability to the organism to adapt to the changes in the environmental conditions. It
right.
will also help in the evolution of the species. So I feel from evolution point of view, sexual reproduction is far better as compared to asexual reproduction.
Right. And now when we are discussing about vegetative propagation, so you have told our viewers and students that it has to be considered as asexual reproduction. So I guess the ginger which you were explaining to us, with the help of that only we could understand that why vegetative propagation is considered as asexual reproduction mode of reproduction. Yeah,
because it does not involve formation of gametes or fusion of gametes, it does not result in any variation. Since it involves only somatic part of the plant or vegetative part of the plant, so it is asexual reproduction, not sexual reproduction. If we talk of sexual reproduction, naturally male and female gametes are involved. Since no gametes are involved here, so vegetative propagation is definitely a form of asexual reproduction.
Okay, so I guess we can discuss this chapter further. Our viewers must be waiting. Yes, you may proceed.
Sure. Okay, thank you. So students, vegetative propagation in ginger or rhizome, it takes place again through the buds, axillary buds which are present in the node region in the ginger. So next time when you are eating ginger, make sure that you are able to identify the nodal region because of the presence of scales, and the internodal region and the bud region. So vegetative propagation in rhizome or ginger again takes place through buds. Moving on further to bryophyllum. Bryophyllum is a medicinal plant grown in most of the homes because it has a lot of medicinal importance for treating ulcers also, and otherwise for simple skin diseases also. Bryophyllum, you would have noticed, children, when its leaves fall down in the soil, gradually these leaves, they start showing thread-like structures in the notches in the margins of the leaf, and these thread-like structures are rhizoidal part or the root-like part. Gradually you see small branches and leaves also coming, and you would notice that within few days and within a month, new plants are surrounded in the region where the original bryophyllum plant was growing. So in bryophyllum, since the adventitious buds, they are present in the marginal notches of the leaf and they help in the growth of new plant. So here we say vegetative propagation is occurring by the leaves. These were natural methods of vegetative propagation. Looking at the advantages of natural methods of vegetative propagation, farmers are now doing artificial vegetative propagation also. One of the very common examples of artificial vegetative propagation is seen in rose. If you have rose in your garden, you would have generally seen we do not grow new rose plants through the seeds. What do we do then? We simply take a stem cutting of the rose. But while we take stem cutting of the rose, we make sure that we cut the stem in an oblique manner at an angle of 35 degrees. Moreover, the stem cutting should have at least two nodes, because one region we will sow under the soil and the other region will be exposed. So one node, the cells will divide and they will result in the root formation, and the other node, which is in the aerial part, that will help in the shoot formation. So for growing rose, we hardly use seeds, we use stem cuttings. When we talk of other flowering plants like jasmine, layering is very popular in jasmine. Here, the long branches, a part of it is defoliated, that means leaves are removed, and then it is bent towards the soil and pegged into the soil. That means it is partially covered with the soil. The part of the branch which is pegged into the soil, the node region in this area will develop adventitious roots. Gradually, this branch, it detaches from the main plant and then it develops into a new plant. So this method of propagation, vegetative propagation in jasmine, it is called as layering. When we talk of fruit trees such as mango, apple, guava, etc., students would have seen that some farmers, they see that one variety is good in some particular feature and another plant have fruits which have another good feature. So when the farmers feel that they want to combine two desirable features of the same fruit in two different plants, then what do? They take stem cutting or scion from one particular plant, that is one variety of mango tree, and the root region of the other variety of the mango tree. The root region where it is taken, that is called as stalk, and the stem region where it is taken, it is called as scion. Again, these are obliquely cut so that their joining becomes easier. The cambial activity takes place when they join. So these scion and stalk, they are joined together by a wax which is called as grafting wax, and then they are wrapped and tied with the natural rope. Gradually the cambial activity takes place and both of them join together and they behave as if they were one tree. When you get fruits from this tree, you will have desirable features from two different trees of the same variety of the fruit. So this technique is a technique of artificial vegetative propagation, very popularly used by the farmers. When we talk of sexual reproduction, so these were the methods we were talking of, asexual reproduction, whether natural or artificial. Now let's talk about the sexual method of reproduction, which is common in higher animals as well as higher plants. Let us relate it to human beings. If we talk about the various phases in the growth on the in the human being, we can divide these phases into three main categories. The first phase is the childhood phase or the juvenile phase, in which the height increases, the vegetative growth takes place. The second phase is the adulthood or the reproductive phase, which is marked by or begun by puberty or adolescent stage. Here, the reproductive organs mature and they are able to produce gametes, and the reproductive capability is there in the organism. After the adulthood, gradually the aging process begins, which is also called as senescence. Metabolic activities gradually slow down, and when the metabolic activity is completely stopped, it results in the death of the organism. These phases of growth are not only found in animals, the plants show similar phases. The first phase is the vegetative phase or the juvenile phase, in which the new leaves are coming, the new branches are coming. The next phase is the reproductive phase. When you are able to see flowers in the plant, it is an indication that the reproductive phase has begun, because flower is the reproductive organ in the plant. Gradually, when the plant grows, matures, and its leaves start falling down, shedding down, and it is moving towards aging process, that is, the senescence begins and it results in the death of the organism. In the sexually reproducing plants, we can classify the sexually reproducing plants into two main categories: monocarpic plants and polycarpic plants. Mono means one, poly means many, carp means fruit. So those plants which flower only once in their life cycle, and after flowering they form fruits, and then they die after flowering and fruiting, they are called as monocarpic plants. When we talk of plants which flower repeatedly after maturity, say mango or banana or many other tall trees, they do not die after flowering and fruiting in one season. They are perennial plants. They live year after year. Whereas monocarpic plants, they can be annual, biennial, or very few of them may be perennial. Let's talk more about them. Monocarpic plants, as we said, they can be annual, say for example rice and wheat. In these annual plants, there will be 3 to 4 months of vegetative phase followed by a reproductive phase, that is when the flowers are formed, then the grains are formed, and once the grains are formed, after that the senescence occurs and they die. So within 1 year, the vegetative phase and the reproductive phase both are completed, and then it results in the death of the organism. When we talk of carrot or radish, they are biennial monocarpic plants. In one season, they will show the vegetative phase. In the next season, they will show the reproductive phase, that is the flowering and fruit formation takes place. After fruit formation, they die, that is, they complete their life cycle in 2 years. That is why they are called as biennial plants. When we talk of monocarpic perennial plants, bamboo is the most common example that comes to our mind. Students, in the previous episode also, we had told you that bamboo may have a vegetative phase of as long as 50 years. Till 50 years, there may not be any flowers. So after around 50 years of age, it will show flowering, and after that, it may die. When we talk of sexual reproduction, whether it is monocarpic or whether it is polycarpic or whether it is annual or biennial or perennial plants, the common feature in all of them is that sexual reproduction, it results in the formation of male gamete and the female gamete. male gamete and female gamete, both of them are always haploid. They have single set of chromosomes. These haploid male and female gametes, they undergo fusion. This is called as fertilization, which is the key feature of the sexual reproduction. Fertilization results in the formation of a diploid zygote. This diploid zygote undergoes embryogenesis. Depending upon whether the adult plant or adult organism is haploid or diploid, we may have different kinds of cell division, which may result in formation of gametes. The events which are very common in all stages of sexual reproduction are categorized into three main categories. One is pre-fertilization events, that is the events which take place before fertilization, right? So these pre-fertilization events are mainly formation of gametes, that is gametogenesis, and then we will talk of transfer of gametes. After pre-fertilization events, when the gametes are formed, the fusion or fertilization of gametes will take place. And then once the fertilization has taken place and the zygote has been formed, it will lead to post-fertilization events, that is the embryonic development. The pre-fertilization events mainly involve gametogenesis, that is formation of gametes, and then transfer of male gamete to the female gamete to facilitate the process of fertilization. Students, when we talk of gametogenesis, the gametes can be identical in size and shape, that is, they can be homogametes, which are there in algae, but majority of the organisms, they show two different sizes in the male and the female gamete. Male gamete is generally motile and small, microscopic. Female gamete is generally large, and it has more of the cytoplasm. So thus, in most of the organisms, the gametes are heterogametes, small microscopic male gamete and a large macroscopic female gamete. Depending upon whether the adult organism is haploid or diploid, different kind of divisions may take place for formation of gametes. Gametes are always haploid, that is, they have n number of. If the adult organism is also having n number of chromosomes, that is, if adult is also haploid, then the number of chromosomes in adult as well as the gametes is identical. That is, equal number of chromosomes are there. So this kind of cell division, which results in the formation of haploid gametes when the adult organism is also haploid, this is mitosis. And such a life cycle is called as haplontic life cycle. Here, the meiosis will take place after zygote formation, that is during embryogenesis, the reductional division takes place so that the haploidy is restored. When the adult organism is diploid, that is, it has 2n number of chromosomes, then the meiosis division takes place or reductional division takes place for the formation of gametes. A very important and a unique event which takes place and which shows that evolution has definitely taken place is parthenogenesis. Students, you would be surprised to know that in some organism, although the gametes are formed, but the new organism develops without fertilization by sperm. So when reproduction involves formation of adult organisms from the unfertilized egg, it is also called as virgin birth or parthenogenesis. It is very common in honeybee, in turkeys, in lizards. Turkeys and lizards, they show natural parthenogenesis. In some species of lizards, you would be surprised to know, male organisms are not even seen in nature. So, no sperms are produced, only eggs are produced, and these eggs, unfertile eggs, they form adult organism by embryogenesis. Parthenogenesis also takes place in honeybees. In honeybees, the diploid is the queen. There are three categories of the organism, that is queen bee, the drones, and the workers. worker and the queen bee are diploid, they form the eggs by meiosis. And if this egg is fertilized by the sperm, it results in the formation of a diploid organism, which forms one queen bee, which is fertile, and several sterile workers in the colony. If the egg is not fertilized, that is, the haploid egg is there, and this haploid egg, it develops into new organism, which is again haploid. These are called drones. So males are drones, which are haploid. The females are diploid. They can be queen bee if it is fertile, or they can be workers if they are sterile. When we talk of gametes, after formation of gametes, the next step is transfer of the gametes. The medium for the transfer of gametes can be water. So the fertilization, when it takes place in water, it is called as external fertilization, as we see in frog and in some fishes. In frogs, the male frog releases the sperms in the water, and the female frog releases a spawn of eggs in the water. Within the water, the male and the female gametes fertilize, they form the zygote, and then the zygote develops into the tadpole, and gradually the morphogenesis takes place and the adult frog is born. So in frog, fertilization as well as development is external. Similarly, in fishes, the eggs as well as sperms, they are laid in water. Students, you must remember, when fertilization is external, there has to be synchrony in the gametogenesis. That is, the male and the female gametes, they have to be released simultaneously in water for successful fertilization. In humans and other birds and mammals, the fertilization is internal because it takes place within the oviduct, the female. In plants, the fertilization takes place within the oviduct, that is within the ovule of the flower. So the agent for the transfer of the male gamete may be different. That is, generally wind or insects or bats, there can be various agents of the transfer of the pollen grain. Pollen grain is the carrier of the male gamete. So if pollen grains, they are transferred onto the stigma of the same flower, it is called self-pollination, and it does not result in variation. If the pollen grains, they are transferred from one flower to another flower on a different plant of the same species, and it falls on the stigma, and then the pollination is cross-pollination. Cross-pollination definitely results in variation. So whether it is animals or plants, the most important event in both of them during sexual reproduction is formation of zygote by fertilization. After zygote, the next step is embryogenesis, or development of the embryo. We had seen in frog, the fertilization was external. Embryogenesis was also external because tadpoles are produced in water. Whereas birds, you would have definitely observed that they lay eggs in the nest. And you would have also noticed that these small birds, they develop within the nest. So the embryogenesis in the birds as well as in the reptiles, it is external. If we talk of mammals, including humans, the development of the embryo, that is fetal development, it takes place within the body of the mother. So on the basis of the fact whether the development is internal or external, the animals can be classified as oviparous, that is the egg-laying animals. They lay fertilized eggs, and the embryogenesis is external. When we talk of human beings or other mammals, here the fertilization is internal, that is, the zygote is formed within the body of the female, and the embryogenesis also takes place within the body of the female. So this kind of development is internal, and such animals are called as viviparous animals. In plants, again, the fertilization is internal. as we told students that the pollen grains or the male gametes, they are transferred to the stigma of the flower. Similarly, when we talk of simple plants such as bryophytes, that is mosses, which bear the gametophyte, that is the antheridia and the archegonia. If the male gamete, that is the anthrozoid, is carried over to the archegonia and the fertilization takes place within the archegonia, this kind of fertilization is internal, that is in lower organism, lower plants. In higher plants too, the fertilization is internal. The pollen grain, which is the carrier of the male gamete, it falls on the stigma, it germinates, it forms the pollen tube, and this pollen tube carries two male gametes. One of the male gamete fertilizes with the egg cell to form a diploid zygote, and the other male gamete, it undergoes triple fusion to fuse with two secondary nuclei, and it forms PEN, which results in the formation of triploid endosperm for the nourishment of the embryo. So, bryophytes, pteridophytes, and higher plants, they all show internal fertilization. Internal fertilization has resulted in the form of zygote. So, after zygote, just like we saw that in animals, the embryogenesis takes place, here also the post-fertilization takes place. Post-fertilization changes take place. One of the very important post-fertilization changes is development of the fruit. After fertilization, the ovary ripens and it forms the fruit. The ovule ripens and it forms the seed. What happens to the remaining parts of the flower? Students, when ovary has formed the fruit, ovule has formed the seed, the integument of the ovules, they form the seed coat. The sepals of the calyx and petals of the corolla, they form. So these are the changes which result in the seed formation and fruit formation. The primary endosperm nucleus, which was the triploid nucleus which was formed after double fertilization, it results in endosperm. The fertilized egg forms the zygote. The zygote undergoes multiple cell divisions and it results in the formation of embryo. This embryo forms the baby plant. So these are the post-fertilization changes that take place in higher plants. Students, let's summarize about the various events in the sexual reproduction. Before we do that, we can have a look at the variety of the seeds and the fruits that you see in your neighborhood. I'm sure you would have seen pea pod. The seeds that you see in the pea pod, they are aligned along the margin of the pod. This pea pod was actually the ovary before the fruit formation. And these pea seeds that you see within the pod, they were the ovules. I'm sure you would have seen tomato in your kitchen. You just cut the tomato. You see a large number of seeds in the tomato. So these seeds were ovules before fertilization. The bitter gourd or karela, I'm sure you would have seen the seeds in it. Of course, we call them as vegetables, but biologically or technically, it is a fruit. The vegetable, the bitter gourd or karela that you eat, it is a fruit which contains a large number of seeds in it. Similarly, the mustard or the cucumber or the kheera that you eat, you would have seen a large number of seeds in kheera. So that kheera, that is a fruit technically, and before ripening, it was a small ovary which had several ovules. After fertilization and ripening, you are able to see the seed. So when you are eating any vegetable, now onwards, remember, just look at the seeds and try to trace the events that might have resulted in the formation of these seeds and these fruits. Let us now recapitulate what all we have studied during this lesson today. Students, reproduction is an important event which maintains continuity of the species. Reproduction can be of two main kinds, asexual or sexual. If it is uniparental, does not involve any gametes, does not involve meiosis, does not result in variation, it is asexual reproduction. An event of evolution between asexual and sexual reproduction is represented by parthenogenesis or virgin birth. Here, the eggs are formed, but the unfertile eggs, they are capable of giving birth to new organism. It is very common in lizards, in turkey, in honey. Sexual reproduction, a very important event for producing variations in all higher plants and animals. It can show two diverse variety of plants. There can be monocarpic plants or polycarpic. If only one flowering season occurs before the death of the plant, it is monocarpic. And if the plant produces flowers and fruits for several seasons, it is polycarpic. The events before fertilization are mainly formation of haploid gametes, which is called gametogenesis, and then the male gamete has to be transferred to the female gamete, which results in fusion. The gametes can be identical or isogametes, and if they differ with respect to size and shape, they can be heterogametes. For transfer of male and female gametes, there can be agencies for pollination, which could be abiotic, such as wind or water, and it could be biotic, such as insects, animals, or birds, etc. After formation of gametes and their transfer, the gametes fuse, that is, the male and female gametes undergo fertilization, which results in the formation of zygote, which is definitely a diploid structure. The zygote may divide by meiosis if the adult organism is haploid, and it may divide by mitosis to form diploid organism. Zygote undergoes embryogenesis, and then the new organism is formed. Before the embryogenesis, the fruit and the seed are the form, that is, the ovary ripens to form fruit and the ovule ripens to form seed. This is how embryogenesis takes place in plants and animals. I hope you have understood various events related with asexual and sexual reproduction.
Right, Ms. Mridula, and I can see many viewers are watching us live. Viewers, you may send all your queries and questions if you have in the discussion we had in last 1 hour. So, as we discussed the asexual and sexual reproduction in detail, here are small questions, Mrs. Arora, if you could just please address. You discussed about meiosis and gametogenesis. So,
Yes. Why
they are considered to be interlinked?
Okay. See, gametogenesis is the process of formation of gametes. Gametes are always haploid, that is, they have single set of chromosomes. If adult organism is diploid and have two sets of the chromosomes, then it is very essential that the reduction of the chromosome number takes place. So meiosis is a kind of cell division which results in the reduction of the chromosomes. Thus, meiosis and gametogenesis are interlinked, because without meiosis, gametes cannot be formed if the adult organism is diploid.
Okay. Mr. Arora, we have got a question on our official YouTube streaming. One of our viewer wants to ask you, Mubinul Haq is the name of the viewer. He wants to ask you, what is parthenogenesis? How does it occur?
Okay. Parthenogenesis can also be called as virgin birth.
Okay.
Parthenogenesis is a stage, evolutionary stage between asexual and sexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, generally gametes are not formed. In parthenogenesis, the female gamete is formed, but it does not result in fertilization. Say, for example, in lizard, few species of lizards, male is not even seen. When the male organism is not there, that means the sperms are not there. When the sperms are not there, that means fertilization of male and female gamete does not take place. So how will the species continue to live then? So here, unfertilized egg, it develops into the new organism. So this kind of reproduction where gametes are formed, but without fertilization, they result in the formation of the new organism or the young one. It is parthenogenesis. It is very common in turkey, few species of lizard, very common in honeybee. In honeybee, the males are haploid and the females are diploid. So without fertilization, the drones are produced, the haploids are produced, the males are produced. So that is parthenogenesis.
Okay, so with that, we are coming almost to the end of today's session. Viewers, if you have any questions, then do write. We have another 2-3 minutes left. There is one more question, Ms. Arora. Could you please elaborate the difference between gametogenesis and embryogenesis?
Okay. Genesis means formation. Gametogenesis means formation of gametes. And embryogenesis means formation of embryo. Gametogenesis is an event which takes place before fertilization. So it is a pre-fertilization event. It results in the formation of haploid gametes. If the adult organism is haploid, the gametogenesis will involve mitosis. If the adult was diploid, it will involve meiosis. Embryogenesis is formation of embryo from the zygote. The zygote divides repeatedly and it forms the embryo. If the adult organism is haploid and the zygote was diploid, then first division will be meiotic, that is reduction of the chromosome number. And after that, mitotic division will take place. But if adult organism is also diploid, zygote is also diploid, then several mitotic divisions will take place and it will result in formation of embryo. So gametogenesis is pre-fertilization event, resulting in formation of gametes. Embryogenesis is post-fertilization event, resulting in the formation of embryo.
Okay, so with that, we come to the last question of today's discussion. There's a question I would like to ask you. Why are offsprings of oviparous animals are at a greater risk as compared to the offsprings of viviparous animals? If you could please throw some light on this as well, Mrs. Arora.
See, oviparous animals are those animals where the fertilization is internal and they lay fertilized eggs. So the prenatal development, it is in the external medium. So they are not secured in that external medium. They are prone to be eaten by predators. The environmental stress conditions may also harm the embryo and the nutritional requirement may also not be completed. So they are more prone to stress conditions because of the environment, non-availability of the nutrition, and they may be prone to predators. So their chances of getting killed are more as compared to viviparous animal, because here the embryo is safe within the mother's body. Mother takes care of the embryo, mother nourishes the embryo, so it is well protected and well nourished. So it is definitely in the safe environment. So the chances of survival of the embryo in viviparous animals are much more than in the oviparous animals. Because any bird or any animal can eat the eggs or the young embryos that are lying in the nest. Whereas that is not possible in the viviparous animal because embryo is well protected within the body of the mother.
Okay, so that was all viewers from today's biology session for Standard 12 students. And I really thank our expert for today, Mrs. Mridula Arora ji, who joined us and explained so beautifully about this chapter today. Thank you, Mrs. Arora, for joining us today.
Thank you, Kriti, and thank you, dear viewers. Namaskar.
I would request all our viewers to remain connected to PME with their to watch NCRT's resource material. Stay healthy, stay happy, and maintain social distancing, viewers. Thank you. Namaskar.